Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free 1 week trial. Just $4.99 a month for your all access pass. Playing now on Fandor is Butt Boy. In this film, Detective Fox loves work and alcohol. After going to AA, his sponsor Chip becomes the main suspect in his investigation of a missing kid. Detective Fox starts to believe that people are disappearing up Chip's butt.
Hey everyone, welcome to another Fandor video podcast. He is, the Chris Kelly.
There we go.
How are you feeling today, Chris?
I'm doing well. I'm doing really well.
Okay, good. And our amazing producer, Bryn. Hey,
you guys look beautiful today. I don't know what it is. Just maybe the sunlight, the amazing sunlight or something. But right. You guys just look phenomenal.
Well, we have a very special guest. I don't know very much about him. I know he's part of the Napa Film Festival, which is coming up. And his name is Herb.
All right.
Hey, Herb.
Herb Stratford.
Thanks for having me, guys. Nice to be here.
Herb, what do you do in regards to the Napa Film Festival?
So I'm the director of programming, which really means I lead the film selection and recruitment process. And so not only looking at, you know, the films that are submitted, but also chasing films all year long and, you know, staying in touch with directors and saying, hey, we'd like to show your film. And, you know, pretty much just sort of running herd on all things film related.
Is Napa the only organization you do this for?
Actually, no. It's interesting. I've had sort of an interesting path. I restored a historic theater in Tucson, Arizona, and then I started programming films there. Okay. Started a couple film festivals in Tucson. Started working in Napa in 2012, 13, 14.
Because the weather's better?
And then I came back to Napa this year, and I also do some work for Sonoma and Mendocino as well. So I'm sort of the Northern California film guy.
Nice. So how many movies would you say you watch a year?
I would say that depending on the year, because I'm a member of the Broadcast Film Critics Association too, so I would say I watch between 1,000 and 1,200 films a year.
What?
That's pretty serious.
That means you watch three movies a day.
Yeah.
Some days, and some days you watch five or six and don't watch any the next day.
So what's a vacation look like for you? Is there a vacation in your life at all?
You know, usually vacations include some film watching and also visiting historic theaters if I can talk my way in the door. So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. I want to ask you a question that you 100% aren't going to be honest about, but I got to ask you.
All right.
Do you find that you're sometimes not giving the attention and the awareness to a movie that it deserves because you've watched so many movies that day and you have to go back and rewatch it and say, that was actually a lot better than I thought, but I was so tired and I was so hungry. Has that ever happened?
Oh, yeah. No, sure. And you know, you try and multitask. You know, sometimes you have something on and you know, you're trying to, you know, give it the attention, but you have other deadlines. And, I have found myself giving things a second chance or going back again to look at things because, you know, sometimes it's your point of view, right? If you're tired or you're crabby or something, you may not have given the film 100% attention like you would in a theater environment, right? But if you're at home, you got all these distractions and, you know.
So, and then sometimes you go back and say after saying it couldn't have been that bad, and then you watch it again, you're like, no, it was.
That happened?
It has happened. I will tell you that, you know, there's a difference between being a broadcast film critic. You know, I'm on radio and TV every week, but, you know, those films, right, that have a wide release that you're talking about because they're in the multiplex or whatever. And then there's the films that you're seeing, you know, that are submitted to festivals. And there's some things that are really remarkable and you just can't wait to share it with your audience. And there's other people you're like, wow, that was I applaud you for making a film. But I wish I had back.
Really remarkable and not in a good way.
So let's
A for effort.
Right. Let's talk about Napa. When is the film festival?
So Napa this year is a streaming virtual fest, and it's basically November 10th to the 14th. So it's our normal time. We're just not in person this year. We're just on the streaming platform, which is L-Event, which a number of festivals have done. I think Chicago, Seattle, a number of festivals have used this platform very successfully, and we're very pleased with it. It's a great way for us to showcase these films that we're anxious to show.
And how many films are you guys showing this year?
So we're showing about 65 films during the festival, and that includes shorts and features. And then we also have a tribute program that we're really excited about, where normally we would do some of our tributes in person, but we've gone ahead and we've pre-recorded those. So, you know, we have like Harvey Keitel and Marlee Matlin, you know, some really great folks in our tribute program. So you're still going to be able to get that experience. You're just going to be able to watch it over and over again at home.
Yeah, the tribute program at the Napa Valley Film Festival has been exceptional over the years. I mean, the Matthew McConaughey, John Travolta, Will Ferrell. There's been a whole bunch of great, great people who you've brought up. And when it gets back to in person next year, we hope and expect, I think that that'll all be fantastic. But it's great that you're continuing it on the virtual platform.
Well, and you know, it's an easy sell when you talk to celebrities and you say, hey, would you like to come up to Napa? Right. We'll have a little conversation with you, celebrate your career, give you a bunch of wine. And, you know, who would turn that down? Right.
Yeah. All you have to do is have dinner with a whole bunch of pain in the ass film people. And I've been at a number of those dinners and they're fantastic.
So is Fandor sponsoring one? Because, by the way, this is the Fandor Video Podcast, the company we work for. Are we sponsoring one of these?
So you are sort of not in a specific sponsorship of one of the tributes. You are sort of an overall sponsor of the tribute program. So you are a sponsor of the program, and we're happy to have you here.
Thank you so much. We're happy to be here.
Yeah.
All right. So tell us a couple of films that you're particularly excited about this year.
So, you know, I'm a particular fan of documentaries, and so we have some really exciting documentaries this year. Frida Mock, who this is her fourth time at the Napa Valley Film Festival with a film. She won the Academy Award for her documentary about Maya Lin. She also won an Academy Award for her first short film that she did. And so she's back with a movie called The Choir and Conductor about the Los Angeles Children's Choir, which is just a really wonderful film. We have a documentary about the art world called The Art of Making It, which is really interesting, following some young artists trying to break into the contemporary art world. And then we've also got a great movie about the documentary about the competitive world of table setting, which hard to believe is actually a thing. It's called
Set.
Hold on, what's it called again?
It's called Set, with an exclamation. Right. And it basically follows a group of individuals at the Orange County Fair who are competing to win the best in show at table setting. Which,
so,
you know,
wait a minute.
This isn't a Eugene Levy, like, you know, mockumentary or, you know.
So, but it is that. So it is very much best in show, but it's not a mockumentary.
It's a real documentary.
So what did you learn about table settings that you could share with us right now?
Well, I think what I learned is, you know, it's not only the rules about, you know, how many forks and knives and how far away they are from the edge of the table, but, you know, where does the napkin go? You know, can you have anything in with the napkin? Are you allowed to have taxidermy on the table? You know, things like that.
So what can you put in the napkin? Can you reveal that to us?
Well,
taxidermy?
Apparently nothing. So if you see sometimes people stick a little like menu or something, you know, in a fold, that's a big no-no. Apparently you have to be able to pick the napkin up without doing anything else and put it down. So you get marked down when you do that.
Oh.
Wow.
And is there a rule about candles? I'm a big candles fan.
You know, I don't recall any rules specifically about candles per se, but you know, the whole thing is, you know, they have to set this table and they have to do it in a way, you know, with a theme. And then there's all these different, you know, they judge them on, you know, color and on, you know, composition. And, you know, it's funny, like when you watch this film, like, you know, one table, I think they forgot a spoon and they get, you know, a big demerit for doing that. And the person's just horrified because how could they forget a spoon? But, you know, you got 500 details.
So they're all flying around and, you know,
So I will say this, Chris and I, and even Bryn, have been to a bunch of bougie dinners. And when you go to a dinner that does have fancy, like a fancy setting, it really does up the level of the event.
Yeah.
It really does. All right. So,
and then, you know, for the folks who consume at these dinners, you just always need to remember outside in. Like that's how you go. That's still the secret, right?
I hope. Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
That is the secret. Yeah.
So what other movies? Is there anything else?
Yeah. You know, there's some really great narrative films. We have a movie called Precarious that I just absolutely love. It's a narrative story that's sort of in this sort of bizarre, surrealistic sort of 1950s world. And it's all handcrafted. The director made all the sets in his living room. And it is just a remarkable film. Love that. A couple of French movies, Fires in the Dark, about a medieval village in France, and Vagabonds, about some homeless people in France. Just some really, really strong film. Winter House with Lily Taylor. Some really strong narrative films as well that I'm so pleased to be able to share with audiences.
So what's could you tell us the cost to be a part of the festival? Do you know that off the top of your head?
Yes, I do. There's two ways to participate. You can get an all access pass for $99, which gives you access to everything. Or if you're just a short film fan, you can buy that for $25. And that pass gets you access to, you know, like 30 some odd short films. So, you know, some of those people just love shorts and that's all they want to consume. And they can do that, too.
Are you accepting payment in crypto?
Oh, good question.
Excellent question, Chris. We are not yet, but maybe in 22.
Okay.
And let's just end with this. For a guy who watches up to 1,200 movies a year, it's unfathomable. You cannot have... Do you have a social life? Be honest. There's no way, right?
It's a
he
very
can watch
small,
movies with other people.
Very small.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, if you're watching 5 movies a day, like, is there ever a time where you... just don't even turn on the TV?
Oh, yeah. No, I actually welcome the quiet sometimes. Or you get on a plane and, you know, you just read a book. It's awesome.
Okay, so for a guy who... Give us 4 movies off the beaten path, or popular movies, it doesn't really matter, that you really love, that really talk to you, that you love to share with us.
Yeah, so, you know, you put me on a spot with this one, because, I mean, you know, every year there's more movies that I love. But I there are a couple things stand out recently. Embrace of the Serpent, I just absolutely loved. The black and white film about the Amazon. And I don't know if you guys remember that one. That was about 2018, maybe. Birds of Passage in 2019 in Colombia, about sort of when the drug trade took over and the impact it had on indigenous people. These are narrative films, beautiful films. I thought The Sound of Silence was really an overlooked film with Peter Sarsgaard. Just fabulous film. And then also going a little bit further back, I loved War Witch, which I don't know if you guys remember seeing that one, but that was set in the Congo, and it was just a really eerie, amazing film. So, yeah, I'm always impressed by these stories that we get to share and the fact that festivals really are, you know, a large part of the distribution market for filmmakers, because somebody has to help raise the awareness of these titles, because there's just so much white noise out there. We've got to shine a light on some filmmakers.
That's why we're here. That's what we're doing. We are raising the awareness.
Fandor Festival podcast is about raising awareness.
That's the whole point of Fandor. Thank you, Herb, for saying
Absolutely.
No. All right. Remind us one more time, what's the website for Napa Valley Film Festival?
So it is NapaValleyFilmFest.org. And if you go there, you can go in and get a pass. And you can also take a look at all of the little descriptions of the films, and you can see, you know, who our tribute artists are this year. And again, do that ahead of time, so you're all geared up and ready to go on November the 10th.
Awesome.
So great.
Well, Herb, thank you so much for your time. You're very seasoned. We interview a lot of people. You got incredible enthusiasm. You're really knowledgeable. I mean, you're the total package. I have a feeling Sundance is going to recruit this guy.
There we go. I mean, you know, change over in the executive director, you know, phase. So new executive director may want her own new team. So.
Herb, if they asked you to be the executive director of Sundance, would you say yes?
Oh, I don't know about that. That sounds like, you know, that sounds like I wouldn't get to watch as many films.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, Herb, we wish you nothing but the best, man. Thanks so much, brother.
Thanks. Thank you. Thanks, guys. Right.
Thanks for tuning in. Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free 1-week trial. Playing now on Fandor is Butt Boy. In this film, Detective Fox loves work and alcohol. After going to AA, his sponsor Chip becomes the main suspect in his investigation of a missing kid. Detective Fox starts to believe that people are disappearing up Chip's butt. That's F-A-N-D-O-R. The home for cinephiles.